going to engage in another resilience practice, and this one is a little bit more active than the other practices that we've engaged in, and this is specifically connecting us to the domain of the physical domain of resilience. And we want to be able to have take time during the day to move the joints, right? Move the joints in the range of movement that's available to you. So I'll invite you to stand if that's available. If not, if standing is not an option, you can sit in the chair and let your legs come out a little bit in front of you. It'll give you more of a sense of feeling grounded. It'll give you more access to movement coming to the edge of your chair if you're seated. So we're going to begin with the top of our head. So whether you're standing or seated, really lift the feet if that's possible. I encourage you to do this in bare feet if you can. And really engage the toes so you feel the feet, you feel the toes, the ball joints, the heels, doing that weight bearing and stabilizing that they do so well. And you might be able to recognize when your feet are that engaged, we're not locked into the joints, right? So that's something that's we can orient ourselves to have an awareness of. I know for myself, most of my life when I am standing, I shift my weight to the heels and I lock the knees, the pelvis collapse and my shoulders come forward, and then my head comes up. So that's something that inhibits the central nervous system where all the organs and glands are housed from fully functioning in healthy, vital ways. So when I can come to standing and really feel the feet engaging, I can feel the muscles in my calves a little bit. I can feel the muscles in my thighs, my quads. I can feel the core because I'm lengthening the torso out of the pelvic bowl and the shoulders come back. So, and when we stand like this, what happens is we find our wiggle. We're able to move the joints in their range of movement because we're not locked into them. We're using the muscles that are supporting them. So beginning with the top of our head, you can even place your hand at the crown so you can feel that crown lifting to the ceiling. And you can remove the hand and just let the head move slowly in a nod. You can even use the breath, inhaling, bringing the gaze up. Exhaling, let the chin come into the chest. Inhaling up. Exhaling down. One more time. And as you come down with the chin into the chest, let your chin come over to one of your shoulders. Breathing in, coming through the other side. We'll do that one more time on each side. And the next time you come through to one side, we'll bring the chin into the chest and the head back up. We'll let the ear move toward one of your shoulders. You can bring your hand up here to massage. You can also bring the other hand just to gently rest. You can stretch the arm out. Breathing in and out, releasing the hand. Let the ear move toward the other shoulder. Feeling that stretch again. Massage is an option. And releasing, and then just inviting yourself to feel sort of like a bobblehead movement, if you will, just feeling the way the head rests on the top of the brainstem, the top of the spinal column there, just feeling where that head rests. And then the shoulders, again, moving to your range of movement, feeling all of the different ways you can move your arms. You might even bring your hand back here to feel where the movement is generated from in the shoulder. It's actually back here. So feeling, letting the arms move, shoulders, feeling the range of movement that's available to you. And then of course the elbows are more hinged. We can explore that. And then we come to the wrists. We have all these small muscle groups here. And many of us spend a lot of time doing repetitive tasks such as typing, writing. So paying attention to your hands, massaging, stimulating blood flow. If you don't deal with carpal tunnel or ulnar nerve radiation, you can do some resistance exercises with your hands. You can use movement to build strengthen these small muscle groups, but inviting movement here. You might hear some snap, crackles, and pops. All right, so we have the head, the shoulders, the elbows, the hands, and then we move to the hips. And one of the things that I notice is I see people bending from the waist. The waist is not a joint. The hips are here. A lot of people put their hands on their hips here. This is actually the top of your lower back. The hips are here. You have that little crease. So we hinge at the hips. If you're gardening or bending down to grab something, you want to hinge. You want to have a bend in your knees and your ankles. And go ahead and move the hips around. You have this ball and socket joint here. If you're seated, you can bring the leg up and find that circular movement. Great. Moving around in the knees. The knees can be problematic because of locking into the joint. So we want to strengthen the muscles around the knees, right? And then your ankles, moving the feet. So just moving the joints, doing this once a day, getting up and from the head down and from the bottom up, moving your joints. And then, of course, I love to find the wiggle. And just for fun, it can be something if you have to get up and use the bathroom, you can find your wiggle on your way there. Might make everybody in your classroom laugh, your coworkers. But finding ways to move your body every day.